Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is Carlos Phoenix, and this is the Indie Lounge. Thank you very much for coming. We have a special guest, Mr. Dave Dorman, sci-fi fantasy illustrator. If you're a comic book collector, you've probably seen his work on the Star Wars covers with Dark Horse, Aliens, Indiana Jones, tons of movies that I'm a big fan of. But he has been pushing the artwork to limits that makes it mind-blowing, and we've been following his artwork for a long time. So thank you very much, Mr. Dorman, for coming.
Well, thank you for having me. Call me Dave, please.
All right, thank you. And let me just get my volumes all up to par so we can hear you clearly.
All right.
And again, I really appreciate you joining us today.
It's my pleasure. I love what I do, and I love to share what I do. So thank you for having me.
Excellent. So Dave, you've been an illustrator for a long time. How many years have you been drawing and painting?
This year will be very close to my 30th year as a professional artist. I had my first sale in 1983, heavy metal cover. And almost closely after that was a Savage Sword of Conan cover, and then some work with Epic Magazine. And then I started doing some comic book work with Kimiko, doing Robotech covers, nice. Line drawing stuff. And then painted covers started to really blossom in the mid-'80s, late-'80s. And I moved into doing some painted covers for some smaller publishers, and then eventually hit Dark Horse with Indiana Jones, followed by Star Wars, and that's when things really took off.
Very nice. Now, basically, I followed you when you were doing the Star Wars covers. I caught a lot of the Aliens covers. Big fan of that, the Predator stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm as a sci-fi artist myself, are those the kind of favorite films that you'd say you'd enjoy?
Oh, absolutely. I've been a science fiction and fantasy fan since I was young. I was reading, Doc Savage, paperbacks when I was
10
and 11 years old. And I was reading comics, since I was 7 and 8 years old. So that's been part of my life since I was a young kid. And when I decided to become an artist, certainly comics was an influence. And paperback covers of that time, especially, Frazetta, the Conan paperbacks, and James Bama doing the Doc Savage paperbacks, Kirby doing comics, Steranko doing comics. These were all big influences on me when I was, in those formative stages, and when I just decided to pursue art as a living. Those were the subject matters that I was interested in doing. So it was sort of a natural flow between, what I enjoyed as far as media goes and what my craft sort of took me in that direction as well. So, yeah, it's been part of my life, all of my life.
So now you went to the Kirby School for
a Kubert School.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Kirby Kubert.
they're both great talents.
They are. So it's an easy mistake for me.
Yeah.
You went there for like a year.
Correct.
Now, is there a particular reason why you just stopped going?
I went in the second year of the school. It was the first year they sort of established themselves as a good art school teaching black and white illustration with a specific interest in comic book illustration. And as most of your fans and artists know, comics are drawn in ink first, traditional comics, drawn in pencil and ink first and then colored separately and then all put together in production for printing. So the Kubert School at that time was only teaching storytelling in black and white, in pencil and ink. And probably about 2 years before that, I had started painting. And so my interest was sort of divided between what I was interested in doing, you know, pursuing continuous panel storytelling in pen and ink, and creating single images in paint. And so I went to the school for 1 year and learned quite a bit about, you know, both the artistic side of me and myself and my interests. And at the end of the year, Joe Kubert, who ran the school back in those days, he brought me into his office and we had a talk. And he knew that I really wanted to paint because he had seen me. Part of my portfolio going into the school was paintings. And I had also painted during the course of the school as well. So he saw me, you know, growing as a painter as well as an illustrator. And we had this discussion at the end of the first year. And he basically told me that the school really didn't have any more to offer me because they couldn't teach me any type of color work, any type of painting at all. And he really put his thumb on it, knowing that's the direction that I wanted to go. It would have been sort of futile to spend, you know, more time and you know, more money in going to school to learn, you know, pen and ink drawing, which, you know, I learned very well, you know, for the year that I was there. And obviously I knew pen and ink drawing before I got to the school. Okay. But he was able to see that I had the passion to be a painter and wanted to be a painter.
Wow.
So he basically encouraged me to follow that path. And so I left after the first year and basically went home and got a part-time job, lived with my folks, and spent all my free time teaching myself how to paint.
All right,
and so about I said, excuse me, I'm coming off a cold. For about two and a half years, about the same time that I would have been in college, I just taught myself how to paint. And after that time period, I started to get professional work. And so it really did pay off in the long run, being able to, you know, put aside the illustration and move into painting. And I mean, I consider what I do illustration now, but it's not pen and ink. It's color. Right. Mm-hmm. I still do pen and ink. My graphic novels are pen and ink. So I feel that I'm pretty well rounded as far as that goes. But my passion still is single image, you know, paintings. And that was one of the formative things, you know, in my life that really got me to where I am. You know, the support of my parents and the fact that Joe Kubert could really, you know, put his thumb on what made this artist tick as far as work goes. And that's what made him a great educator. Hmm. Was that he was able to choose, especially in the first 4 or 5 years of the school, he chose the students that came in. He handpicked them. Hmm. And you can see just looking at the roster of artists that have come out of the school that he knew what he was doing. And we are all grateful for that.
Now, your interest in illustration or in painting, I should say, where did those influences come from? Like, what made you want to really become a painter? Like, were there any particular artists at the time? You mentioned Frazetta.
You know, I was reading a lot of paperback books, so paperback illustration had a lot to do with it. I was also a big moviegoer back in those days, and we lived on an Air Force base in Hawaii, and within walking distance of my house, there were two theaters, and back in the late 60s and early 70s, most of the movie posters for almost every film were some type of illustration. It's not like it is now where it's all photographs and Photoshop. Hmm. Back then, there were beautiful illustrations being done, you know, both graphically and painted. And so they changed the movies every day or every 2 days. Wow. So within a week, you know, you'd have five new posters, and then the next week you'd have five different, completely different posters of different movies that were playing. And so seeing that wonderful art, you know, in that context, and then the paperbacks that I would read during those days, just, you know, drew me in to the dynamics of the art. Mm-hmm. And like I say, the Frazetta Conan paperbacks and the James Bama Doc Savage paperbacks, those were big influences on me. Moving into the 70s, we had Michael Whalen and Boris Vallejo, mm-hmm. Couple of names there. Roy Krinkle did some real fun books in the late 60s and early 70s. There's just a ton of really dynamic science fiction art and fantasy art being done at that time. And so those were all influences that I sort of drew in sort of salivate over and say, you know, I could do this if I work hard, you know, to get there. And so I started painting in, I guess it was probably 1974 or 75. I was a junior in high school. And so I just picked up some brushes and some paints, and I took my, at that time in the mid 70s, Ballantine books, or Bantam books, one or the other, had started doing collections of Frazetta's artwork, which was like the coolest thing, because you had like this 9x12 book of just his artwork. You didn't have to have a stack of paperbacks with just the covers. You had this really cool collection. And so what I did was I took some of those paintings that were in this book, and I tried to copy them stroke for stroke, wow. trying to figure out
the techniques.
Yeah. How he got this sort of transparent look and then have an opaque look over that. And the underdrawing with the sepia paint, and, you know, you start looking at something long enough and you have the paint right there, and you're putting it on the board, and you're seeing how the paint reacts and how opaque it can get and thinned out, you know, how thin it can get. And it sort of eventually melds into being able to figure out what's being done there. So I did that for probably, you know, a year and a half, just copied other people's work and other people's techniques to figure out how I could do that, so that when I did my own drawings, I could start incorporating those looks into my paintings.
Now, what do you paint on most of the time? Do you paint on illustration board?
Or? Right now, I paint on gessoed illustration board. I use Crescent 110, I think. It's a double thick illustration board. And then I coat it with gesso, which is a white acrylic with marble dust in it. So it makes a nice surface for the oil paints to adhere to. And then with that, I can texture the gesso a little bit if I want to incorporate a textured underpainting to go with and complement what I'm doing in the paint.
So is your underpainting or underdrawing in acrylic?
No, actually, the way that I've sort of developed the style is I no longer do an underpainting per se, okay. In the traditional sense, where I would put on sepia tones and render the shadows, you know, put all the lines in and sort of have a tonal painting before I put the paint on. There's a real funny story about that. When I was just starting out, I went to the art store and I said, I want to learn how to paint. And the lady there said, okay, what do you want to paint in? And I didn't know the difference between oils and acrylics, you know, at that time. All I knew is Frazetta painted in oils. So I said, I like to paint in oils. And she said, okay. And then she said, how are you going to do that? I said, I don't know. So she said, well, you know, you got to do this brown, you got to do this brown underpainting first. And then when you put, when that dries, you could put color on top of it. And I go, okay.
Wow.
So, that's what I did. I did, Conan the Conqueror, this big, you know, Conan piece where he's strangling some guys and there's a whole bunch of guys around him. And, it's, I did it in just black tones in oils. And she said, what you want to do is you want to paint the whole board, brown and then take Q-tips and scrape off the paint.
So for the highlights.
The white, yeah, that'll be the highlights coming through. So that's what I did. I got my Q-tips and I did the whole thing. And, you know, it looked okay. And then I started to put color paint on and I, you know, it just looked like muddy gunk.
Wait, now, did you wait till it dried at least?
Oh, yeah, I waited until it dried. Okay, okay. And then, but, you know, I just didn't realize, I didn't know how to paint.
Right.
So, I mean, it sounds easy, you know, you do a brown underpainting and then you put the paint on and you do the painting on top of that. Sure, that's easy enough.
So are you doing like a pencil underdrawing now?
So yeah, what I do now is I do a drawing and this is something that the Kubert School really helped me out with.
Okay.
Was basically I knew early on that the foundation for a good painting is a good drawing.
Right.
And so I do that. I make a fully rendered pencil drawing first, giving me all the details, giving me, you know,
your tonalities.
Yeah, lights and shadows, giving me everything I need to do the painting. And that basically represents exactly what I'm going to paint.
Okay.
And so what I do is once that's done on a piece of vellum tracing paper, I take that, I make copies of it.
Now, hold on. So you do the fully rendered drawing on a piece of vellum paper?
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. So you know, I do it like artists use Photoshop now. In doing layers, they build up, you know, a drawing, put a layer on top of it, build it up a little bit more. I do that with the tracing paper. I start with a piece of tracing paper. I just sort of like circles and sticks and build my composition and build my forms. And then I'll put another piece of tracing paper on top of that, start redrawing it, repositioning things, tightening it up, put a third piece on there, really start tightening up. And by the time I get to the fourth piece, it's exactly what I want. So basically, wow. I'm just rendering, you know, a drawing based on, you know, those levels of changes. As
now,
I
by
go
then,
through.
On the board, you have a fully rendered drawing, though.
Well, yeah. On the tracing paper, what I do is I scan it in. Now, it used to be where I would take it to a copy machine and make a full size copy of that drawing because this drawing is the full size that I'm going to paint.
Right.
So if it's just a, you know, an 8x10 magic card, the drawing's 8x10. You know, if it's a 20x30, you know, big paperback cover or something that needs the size to show the detail, that's the size of the drawing.
Did you ever use that? I remember back in college, we used to use, if you did a small underdrawing or a small drawing and you wanted to amplify it, you used this big magnifying thing that reflected on glass.
I know what you're talking about.
I forgot the name of that
thing. Sort of like a camera obscura thing.
Exactly.
I've used those. I've never found any real world use for them in my artwork. But no, what I would do is I originally started with taking my art, taking that sheet, making a copy of it, and then taking that copy and laying a piece of graphite paper underneath it, and then drawing and transferring the drawing right to the board that I'm painting on, the gessoed board. Now, instead of the copier and all of that stuff, I just scan it into my the computer and just do a printout on 11x17 or whatever multiples of 11x17. that I need for the drawing. And I've found that that's a real good way to be able to make some last minute changes if I want to that drawing. So I can, you know, turn a head a little bit or readjust a figure to make it a little bit more dynamic. I can do that work in Photoshop rather than having to take another piece of tracing paper, put it over, make the change on it, and then erase the other one. But, you know, it saves a little bit of work, but it gives me in the end what I need, which is a copy of that drawing to be able to do the transfer. And that's all still done by hand. I mean, that's just part of my working process. So on the board, what I'll have is I'll have a pencil rendering. Basically, it's an outline pencil rendering because I don't need any shadow at that point because all the shadowing is done on the vellum paper. Mm-hmm. So I'm just doing an outline of all the elements right onto the board. I'll spray fix it, and then I'll just start painting right there. So I'll lay down my background tones. I can lay washes on. Huh. I can do opaques. I'll just start building things, you know, up from there. So there's no real underpainting per se in the traditional sense. It's a line drawing that I'm basically painting on top of.
Wow. And so you just look at the vellum for the tonality?
Yeah, I do that. And then if I've shot reference for the figures, because I get people to come over and pose for me in costume and whatever thing I could manufacture quickly to approximate whatever costume the character is. So I do use photo reference. So I have those handy as well, so they can help me visualize the lights and shadows. But most of that is done on the drawing itself because, like I said, a good drawing will eventually end up as a good painting. So I want to make the best drawing that I can, giving me exactly what I want before I step in with the paint.
Okay. Well, stepping out of the technical, and I do appreciate all that information.
Oh, no problem.
I personally, I do.
Do you have a buzzer that you can wake up people now?
I think our audience should be, you know, would be very interested, especially if they're artists. They'll probably, you know, oh, I didn't think to do that. personally, I do. I paint on masonite board.
Yeah.
And I gesso it, and I actually do a fully rendered drawing on the board itself. So that's how I kind of taught myself how to paint. But okay. So are there any?
Yeah. Early on, I tried painting on masonite because I know that Frazetta did. You know, so you know, I got some pieces of masonite. And they're just really heavy, and the corners tended to chip off. And I said,
"That's true."
I said, "Nah, I'm not going to deal with that."
What I do is I'll tape up the corners so that there's a border. Way I'm not too worried about that. But that being said, are there any subject matters? You know, you've been fortunate to get some of the top subject matters. I mean, that most artists would love to paint. But is there something that you've said to yourself, you know what, I wish I could have done this, you know, whatever it may be, maybe another favorite movie or storyline or something like that?
Like you say, I've been very lucky in being able to do what I've done over the years.
Because I'm jealous, personally.
Well, you know, it all falls into, you know, what I love and being able to incorporate that into what I love to do. And having Star Wars and Indiana Jones so early in my career and being at the right place at the right time with the style that was needed for those, that really opened a lot of doors for licensing, and especially movie tie-ins. Mm-hmm. And so you know, if I heard of a publisher that was doing something that I found interesting, I'd give them a call and to say I'd be interested. Some publishers, you know, came to me because they knew from my resume what I was doing as far as artwork goes. So they knew I could do those likenesses and do a realistic, you know, xenomorph or a very detailed predator or you know, Han Solo, Harrison Ford, right, or Mark Hamill. I would just keep my ears open to what was happening. I did a couple of Buckaroo Banzai pieces because I really love the Buckaroo Banzai film. So I called the guys at Moonstone who were publishing Buckaroo Banzai, and they said, hey, I'd be interested in doing some covers. There was a company that was doing some Doc Savage comics about 15 years ago. And I called them and I said, hey, I'd love to do a Doc Savage cover. So I did sort of my tribute to James Bama. I just feel fortunate and feel very lucky to be able to render this material as I do, and that fits in, you know, very close to what a lot of these publishers want.
Right.
And so, yes, I've had a lot of fun with the subject matters that I've been working on over the years.
Now, let's see, you've worked on these Dark Horse Comics and some of the top companies out there. And I've seen some of your other interviews. They've already asked you about what's happening with Dark Horse's Star Wars and how it's shifting to Marvel. Any remaining thoughts on that? Because I don't want to kill the conversation to death on that. But
I'm anxious to see what Marvel is going to do. I sort of look at it like the prequels. You know, I grew up with the original films, and so did obviously most of my generation. And so when the prequels were coming out, everybody said, oh, it's not going to be the same, and it's going to be terrible. And, you know, some of the people still do say that. But if you talk to, younger generation of kids – who saw the prequels first, you know, they love the stuff. Right. And so as long as the quality of the art and the storytelling is there, and there's stories that engage the reader and keep the adventure of what Star Wars is about, Marvel should do fine. I certainly know that there's a lot of fans out there who are worried that they may throw away the expanded universe, and just deal with characters that already exist from the films, or, you know, create new characters.
Are there any favorite characters you have that are not from the, let's say, original Star Wars universe? Because I know there's the books and the comics created other really fascinating characters. Anything that you find yourself having a favoritism towards?
Not really. I mean, I enjoy the Star Wars universe, so there's a lot of characters that I enjoy that were created specifically outside the films.
Right.
Having done 26 or 28 covers for Crimson Empire, I've really enjoyed those characters, Kirkanos and the Crimson Guard characters and what Dark Horse has done with that. Sort of ties in with the fall of the Empire after Darth Vader's killed, after the Emperor dies. So, you know, those are fun characters to play with. Star Wars has been part of my artistic life ever since I started painting, basically. Not before I started drawing, but those years when I started painting and seeing, you know, the original Star Wars in the theater and the big screen, and seeing those beautifully made ships that were battle worn, and just beautiful to look at, and it really added. Even though I'm painting a single static image, the vision of what I see when I'm creating an image is more like a movie, and I'm trying to capture that one still.
Right.
In my head to be able to generate that image. And so Star Wars was really one of those influential movies that helped me generate and formulate that way of working. Marvel, it's really going to be up to them whether they're going to carry the ball or drop it. I hope that they have some editors And with the help of Lucasfilm, which I know that Lucasfilm would like to, you know, continue the comics. But, you know, Dark Horse had a really good 20-year run of the books. And, you know, Marvel is going to have to be in the top of their game to do it. And they can, but we'll see if they do or not. So I'm just looking forward to, you know, what they do and how they do it. And if I can put my two cents in and do a couple of Marvel covers, I'm not going to argue.
Right.
I know the fans have been asking about that. So,
well, yeah, that's one of the reasons I brought it up, because it, you know, I'm hoping that, you know, your art will be, you know, part of that whole. It's like it just goes together, you know. I mean, I think of some of the. I mean, we all look at the posters and think of.
Drew Struzan.
Correct. And but you know, when we look at the comics, the books and stuff like that, obviously I think of you. So you know, I hope that continues.
And you know, that makes me feel real good, because I put a lot of love of what I do into those covers. Mm-hmm. And I still do now, because I still love it. But to be at the right place at the right time for the resurgence of the interest in Star Wars, I couldn't have thought that would happen in a million years when I saw Star Wars in the theater in 1977. And
who would have thought that would have
continued 13 years later that I would become one of the few recognizable artists in the world by name that is associated with Star Wars.
Absolutely.
It's very humbling.
Okay, so now we've covered that.
Okay.
Now I want to go into your future. I know you have Wasted Lands. Can you give us a little bit of a background on that?
Wasted Lands is a sort of universe that I created years ago. Mm-hmm. And it has a very convoluted background to it. And I'll probably be writing an essay about that at some point, and putting it in this omnibus book that we're working on for the summer. But I won't bore your viewers with that long and involved circuitous history of how Wasted Lands came about. The major thing is in 2001, I released a graphic novel called Rail through Image. And that is sort of the opening genesis of the mythology of Rail and the Wasted Lands. It introduces the characters and sets up the conflict. But I had some problems with Image, and I decided not to follow that up with a second volume with Image. And I let the contract lapse, and everything, all the rights reverted back to me. And excuse me. And unfortunately, by the time that happened, I got involved in some other work, and so it got sort of shuffled to the side. Okay. But it was always in the back of my head, creating new characters and some new plot lines. It's a very expansive world that I've created for Wasted Lands, and Rail is sort of the focal point of the main story, and I have all these other stories that secondary characters are involved in, and we're getting into some of that as well. But the big news for this year, for 2014, is I am reworking my original graphic novel, Rail. I'm recoloring the book completely. Mm. I am relettering the book completely, and I am doing some rewriting on it. After 14 years of having it stewed in my brain, I have a little bit more grasp on the direction that I will be going in the subsequent graphic novels. So there's some changes that I'm doing in the writing of it. We are also in the same reprinted volume going to print some of the other short stories that have appeared in various other comics magazines. There was a short story in Penthouse Comics. There was a story in A1. There was a story in Heavy Metal. Those are all things that we're putting into this one volume that is going to sort of restart the Wasted Lands universe. Okay. And that will be coming out this summer. We will be announcing things on Facebook as we get to that. The book will be published by the book will be published by a new publisher called Magnetic Press, and that's being run by Mike Kennedy. He was the publisher just recently of Archaea Comics. He also has written quite a number of books for Dark Horse, a number of Star Wars one-shots, as well as a science fiction version of Lone Wolf and Cub that they published. He did the adaptation of Aeon Flux for Dark Horse. Nice. He's a very good writer, and he has a lot of material. So he just recently stepped out and started his own imprint called Magnetic Press. And he will be launching a number of books this year. One of those is this Wasted Lands omnibus that will be containing all this material that will relaunch Wasted Lands and Rail to the public.
I imagine a lot of that will be released during the San Diego Comic-Con.
Yeah, that's what we're shooting for right now, is to have the graphic novel ready for San Diego. If we can get it ready in June, we'll do that. I think that we're going to solicit it for June. So we should have it for San Diego.
Okay.
Secondarily, that also ties in with that is I have a pair of a father and son, a pair of gamers that have created a board game based on the Rail Wasted Lands universe, and it's very cool. They've done this combination of card game and board game that's sort of like Risk, where you're a rail baron, so you own certain railroad lines, mm-hmm. and they cross the Wasted Lands, and you end up fighting each other. It's a game that you can have two or three players or up to eight players, so it's like Risk. So you get your area and you want to take over everybody else's area.
Wow.
But you're doing it on trains, these big, giant war trains. Instead of having armies, you get these trains with giant guns and giant armies on them. And so you got this board game. And then you also have a card game element, too, where your cards are your armies. So the player across from you knows where the trains are on the board, but they don't know what type of equipment or army the trains have on them. So you have your own cards that you're seeing, and so you can play back and forth. There's a way you can trade with a partner. It's very cool. We previewed it last year in San Diego, mm-hmm. and we previewed it at Gen Con and did some play testing, and we had some very positive reactions, so we're moving ahead with that.
Are you doing all the artwork to the cards and everything like that?
I'll be doing most of the artwork. There's quite a lot of it to be done, so I may be farming out some of it to some people. And but you know, right now that's something that we are working on to get out for the summer as well. But cool. You know, that takes sort of secondary place to the relaunch of the graphic novel, because the graphic novel is sort of the big thing that's going to introduce everybody. So we got that, and then there's a lot of other smaller things that we're going to do. We got some ebook novels that we're going to be doing that tie in with this, and some other things.
That's a lot of work. That's a lot of
it's a lot of work, and there's a lot of creativity that's going into it, and my mind, you know, is only so big, and I feel my brain dripping out of my ears sometimes because I got too much in my head. Because not only, you know, am I drawing this stuff, I'm creating it from nothing. I'm creating characters from nothing, and you know, I'd like to say I'm a good writer, but I'm not. So writing is very hard for me. I wish it was as easy as painting.
Yeah.
But it's not. And so I have to put a lot of work and a lot of thought into that end of the creative aspect of the projects. But in the end, I've been very very pleased with what I've been doing, and I think I get better with everyone that I do, and it's very, very creatively satisfying.
Now you're doing some stuff with I think it's Wizards of the Coast.
Wizards of the Coast. I've been working with them for quite a number of years. I originally started doing Dungeons and Dragons illustrations back in the mid '80s and late '80s, doing some covers and some single illustrations for the gaming modules. And then that's when they were in Lake Geneva in Wisconsin. And then they moved out to Seattle. And I sort of lost touch with them through the move. They changed people working there. Mm-hmm. And I think 1998, I was doing a show, and the art director for Magic the Gathering card game came up and asked me if I was interested in working on some of the cards. And I started, I think, about an eight-year run doing Magic the Gathering cards.
Wow.
And probably 120 or 130 cards, I guess. Hmm. And that was a lot of fun. And then I got sidetracked with some stuff. So it used to be I had some artwork in every set, and then it sort of backed off a little bit. But now Dungeons & Dragons is releasing a brand new gaming edition for D&D, and they're doing a whole new book on it, and they're going to have a ton of illustrators doing brand new artwork for it, and I'm getting an opportunity to throw in my two cents and do a couple of pieces for them. So it's pretty exciting to be, you know, continue working with them. It's a good company. They certainly have some of the best creative talent in the business, and so I'm very happy to continue to be involved.
You're also working with
Dean Haglund.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've known Dean for quite a number of years. He played one of the what days? What's the name of Dean's character? Yeah. No. He was one of the lone gunmen.
Okay.
He was the one with the long blonde hair and glasses. He's a very funny guy. He's a stand-up comedian and writer, and they hired him to be one of these characters on the show. And he's just a wonderful guy. And I met him when I was doing some X-Files art back in the early 90s, I guess it was. And we've stayed friends ever since.
Great.
And he's doing a book on the conspiracy that canceled the Lone Gunman series after the X-Men or the X-Files went off the air. And so it's a very funny book, and I'm doing a cover for him.
That's cool.
For that. So, his character was Langley. Anyway, he's a great guy. I'm happy to work with him, just as I am, you know, happy to work with any friends in the business. That's what makes this business so fun, is because even though it's a solitary situation where you sit behind a drawing table and you paint and you draw, and then you send it out to the publisher and you do the next piece, and you're in the studio and all you have is your music and, you know, your TV.
Well, now do you photograph the paintings, or do you just send them out?
How do you mean?
Well, like I used to do my illustrations, I used to have a photographer do transparencies, and that's what I would FedEx to the publisher.
Oh, okay. Probably up until maybe 1993, 1994, I would send the artwork directly to the publisher, package it up and send it FedEx. But, you know, you have your percentage of pieces that are going to get damaged. I mean,
right?
It just happens. And so I found a 4x5 transparency camera. A friend of mine gave one to me. And so I started taking my own transparencies of the artwork and then sending the transparencies when I had time. I mean, back in those days, unless you had, you know, a photo lab in your basement. Right. You know, you shoot the transparencies, you take them to a developer. That's going to take, you know, 4 or 5 days. You get it back. You got to check them to make sure that the exposure is right and that it represents, you know, what the painting is, and then you can send off the transparency.
Yeah, I had a friend.
It was a lot more trouble. You know, it guaranteed that the painting wasn't going to get run over by a truck or something.
Right.
And then probably in 1998, maybe, I bought a large format scanner, a 12 by 18 scanner.
Oh.
So I just started scanning my own artwork in, and most of the publishers had started using digital files. So when the painting, if I sent them a physical piece of painting or transparency, they would just scan it in and make it an electronic file anyway.
Okay.
So when I got my scanner, I could send them the electronic file and save everyone a step. And so that's what I did then, and I still do it now. I have the exact same scanner model that I did when I bought it in 98, although that one broke about 7 years after that, and I just bought the exact same model because
that's cool.
It gave me exactly what I wanted. So I'm still using that. And
that's cool.
So I have a little bit more control over the artwork before it leaves the studio, and I don't have to worry about your damage to the artwork anymore. I can't even remember the last time I sent a physical piece of artwork to the publisher. So I'm happy about that.
That's good. Now, how fast do you paint? I mean, you mentioned 100-something paintings for a card collection.
Yeah. It just depends on the piece. For the Magic cards I've done some World of Warcraft cards and some other publisher cards.
Mm-hmm.
The card image is, you know, only that big on the card. You know, so I'm doing like a 8x10 or 9x12 because when it shrinks down, it's still going to tighten up real large. So I don't need to do, you know, an 18x24 piece.
Okay.
For a piece that's only going to be, you know, 2x2.
Right.
So, you know, the drawing aspect of it can take, you know, a couple of days working out all the composition and details and such. But once I get my drawing down, for a small piece like that, 2 days maybe.
Hmm.
As I'm working on the drawing, I'm painting it in my head so I know where everything is going to go, and it's just a matter of really laying the paint on the board and squiggling it around a little bit and saying it's done.
okay.
But if I'm doing a larger piece, you know, an 18x24 or 20x30, it's going to take probably, you know, a week, 10 days to do, just because there's a lot more to cover on the board. I mean, physically, there's a lot more paint to put on. But I'm also still, you know, it's the same amount of detail that I do on an 8x10 that I do on a 20x30. It's just more to it.
Right.
So if I could just loosen up a little bit and you know, do indications, because when you take a 20x30 and reduce it down to like a paperback cover or a comic book cover, everything sort of fills in anyway. But, I mean, that's just me. You know, I like to do the detail in the painting. I like to get in there and you know, do little designs on buttons or chainmail or you know, the hilts of a sword or something like that, not just sort of go boom, 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 boom.
And I imagine you have a collection of all that stuff in some closet somewhere.
Yeah, it's sort of, you know, up in the flat files there, and some of it's in the studio, and some of it's downstairs in the closet.
Well, I meant like the costuming also.
Yeah, that's in bags, you know, big duffel bags full of stuff. And, you know, my son keeps grabbing swords and guns and running around the house. So I don't know where half of that stuff is. I mean, he's 9 years old now, so that's what he does. But, you know, one of these days we'll clean up the house and I'll find everything and put it back. You know, it's just good to have that stuff around because that's, you know, the world that I live in, fantasy science fiction. It's guns and swords and,
yeah, exactly,
and, you know, knives and bows and arrows.
All right. So what I'm going to do now is kind of review some of the things that you'll be doing this year.
Okay.
Denise was kind enough to send me information about some of the activities you'll be doing. So a Pensacon, the weekend of February 21st, I'm sorry. You're going to be judging the Writers and Illustrators of the Future Awards on the weekend of April 21st.
Correct. The Writers and Illustrators of the Future. I've been involved with them for 4 years now, I think. And it's a good forum for both writers and illustrators to try to break into this business. It's a competition, so it is judged.
Nice.
During that time period, right before the ceremonies, they have I've drawn a brain fart here. Where I teach seminars. Seminars. Yes, that's the word. they have seminars taught by professionals. So I go out and I talk to the students and show them what I do. I show them my techniques, give some critique to their work, look at their portfolio and hopefully give them a little direction in where they're going. So it's a good sort of teaching experience for me, and a learning experience for them. And of course, they get the winners get their names out to the public and hopefully be able to start a career with that. So it's a really good thing.
Now, do you ever engage in the conversation of what the future of illustration is going to be? Because, as I'm growing up and I was doing oil painting and stuff, there's always the yap of digital art. And then you're like, uh-oh, well, now do I have to learn a whole new thing? Any thoughts or feelings on that?
I have that discussion every day in my head because you can't avoid it nowadays. There's a big
comic book art has changed digital now, so.
digital is just a tool. Uh-huh. It's like a pencil or a paint and a brush or charcoal or watercolor. It's just a tool to transfer an image that's in your head into something that you can see and share with others. However, the technology that is available today that allows shortcuts to be made by having stock photos and pre-made brushes and all sorts of digital cheats make it easy for someone who has no artistic education to step into Photoshop or Painter and use these tools, pre-made tools, to create art. Mm-hmm. And it's unfortunate that the tools have made the look of the art sort of like a smokescreen to people who don't understand what art is. So they look at those creations and say, okay, that's a nice picture, rather than looking at a piece of art that someone who understands what art is, someone who understands what composition is and color, tone, and value and the things that make a great piece of art great, is getting lost by the people who I call them technicians. Hmm. They're just guys who are sitting behind a keyboard utilizing apps and programs to create art, rather than using the program as a tool to be creative. And that's really my major problem with the technology right now, is that it's just allowing technicians to sort of overtake the artist. I would love to learn computer painting. I just don't have the time to learn a new tool right now.
Right, exactly.
Because it's a long learning curve, and I have my clients who still understand and respect traditional art, and I'm happy to give it to them. And I will never give up traditional art because I like to get my hands dirty. I like the smell of the paint. You know, I like to touch the canvas, and the canvas can give you things that a digital piece cannot give you.
Right, absolutely.
Every pixel has the same level in it, where if you look at a traditional piece, you're going to see weight to the paint. You're going to see opaqueness. You're going to see transparency. You can see through one layer of paint to the next. Mm-hmm. Those three-dimensional aspects of what traditional paint can do will never be able to be captured digitally. But that doesn't negate that the digital is still a tool to be used.
Right.
But, you know, to learn to use the tool right, I would need to take off a significant amount of time to sit in front of the computer and learn the tool. And unfortunately, I don't have that time right now. I hope to before I get too decrepit to be able to hold the stylus and, what am I doing now? I can't see it. I'm hoping to be able to do that. And I'm playing with it. You know, I'm recoloring the rail graphic novel in the computer.
Okay, cool.
So, you know, there's a learning curve there, but, you know, I'm certainly learning something. And those bits will help me, you know, once I get into, you know, trying to render paint-like, you know, pixels, you know, in Photoshop or Painter.
Awesome. All right. Yeah. Well, let me go through the list.
Sure.
You're going to be doing the last weekend in April at C2E2.
C2E2 is the local comic show here in Chicago. I think this is its fourth year. It's a very good show. They put Reed is the company that puts on the New York convention, and they put on this one as well. And it's a very good show. I'd recommend it to everybody. Wizard World used to be the premier Chicago show here for years and years and years after they bought the Chicago Comic Con. Mm-hmm. And I can't recommend people attend it. If they're going to spend their money on a convention, go to C2E2.
Right.
I'll be set up there in Artist Alley. I'll have prints and books to sign. I do sketches. I do, signing is free. I don't charge. It's a good show. It's right down the road, so I can come home and spend a night in my own bed.
That's good.
That's always good.
All right. Now, the last weekend in May, you're going to be at the Indie Pop Con in Indianapolis. In July, you're going to be at the San Diego Comic Con. That's the big one. Labor Day weekend.
That's the big one, yes.
Yeah, that's the big one. You're going to be at Gen Con promoting the new game Rail. So that's going to be exciting. And then, of course, in October, a fraction of probably what the San Diego is, it will be the New York City Comic Con.
Right. I first went to New York last year. I've been hearing a lot of good things from my friends about it. It just comes at a bad time of year for me. Because being a freelancer, a lot of companies like to gear up their promotion for the following year at the end of the previous year.
Right.
So from September to January, I'll be doing work that'll come out the following summer. So it's usually a busy time for me. Last year, I made the time to go out to New York. It's a real good show. It was big. It was definitely could at some point be a competitor to San Diego. Mm-hmm. I'll definitely be going back. A lot of fans out there. I hadn't been to New York in years and years and years. I haven't done a show in the Northeast in a long time. So a lot of fans were very happy to see me come out last year.
Now, and you may not know this because we kind of talk over the phone, but I'm in Atlanta. And we have a show, and my hair's all digitized. I'm sorry. We have the Dragon Con.
Right.
Dungeons and Dragons, Wizards of the Coast.
Sure.
Just a thought.
Yeah. Well, people who follow me on Facebook know my reasons why I haven't attended Dragon Con over the years. and I'm really not going to get into it.
Not a problem.
But from what has been happening recently, I am going to reconsider going possibly this year. I just have to see what the shakeout of things that have been happening is. But yeah, I have a lot of friends who I lived in Fort Walton Beach for years and years and years. And so the Atlanta shows used to be sort of my local shows, a 5-hour drive, but right. You know, those were the big shows. The Atlanta Fantasy Fair and the Dragon Con were both, you know, big sort of local shows for me. So
yeah, I think in the local show, the Comic Con, the Dragon Con, I know there were some legal issues that had occurred recently, and so I don't know if that's
part right. Of that's it. That's all part of the situation that has kept me away over these years.
Well, hopefully that'll be cleaned up, and hopefully the Atlanta fans will at least get to see a glimpse of you, because that would be awesome.
I would like to go back to Atlanta, you know, we'll just see how it shakes out. But a lot of fans ask me every year if I'm coming, and unfortunately, I have to say no. But if, like I say, if things work out to my satisfaction with those problems, yeah, I'll return to Dragon Con.
Yeah, because they'll probably get a lot of requests for zombie drawings.
Yeah, okay. And I'm happy doing that.
Well, Dave, I think we're going to end it off there. I appreciate so much the time that you've given us. We actually broke an hour, so I'll see.
Oh, really?
And then that's fine. It's the web, so you know, hopefully we'll keep the
attention. Feel free to edit it to 15 minutes and keep people awake.
Well, I appreciate all the information. Thank you very much, Dave, and thank you guys for watching. Hopefully we're going to have a lot more artists related to the comic book industry coming to the show. And Dave has been one of our first special guests. Again,
well, it's been a pleasure being here with you. I'll certainly keep an eye out for the other interviews, because you never know what I can pick up from here and there and the other artists. So good luck with things in the future on that.
I appreciate that very much. And I'll send you a link. And thank Denise as well. Denise, Dave's wife. And hopefully we'll have more artists coming from her side as well. So,
All right.
Thank you guys. Have a great night.
Good deal.
Enjoy. Take care.
All right. Good night, everybody.